talk for general audience. It was going to be given by Laurent Roulet and about the construction of the, well, from the archive Poincaré, and he was going to talk about the construction, the biography of Poincaré.
Thanks. So it's a great honor for me to be here, and I will inflict upon you my terrible Lorraine accent. But Poincaré was Lorrain, so I'm like him. So, who was Henri Poincaré? It was not he, of course. So Poincaré was not a famous politician. He was not deputy, he was not minister, senator, prime minister, and so on. So this is the first problem with Henri Poincaré. His cousin Raymond, who did not compete in the same league, is more widely known than him, and there's a frequent confusion in the general public between the two men. But if Henri Poincaré was not Raymond, who was he? So we have his professional life. So you can see, and you know, that he was a professor at Caen and then at the Sorbonne, that he taught at the École Polytechnique, at the École Professionnelle Supérieure des Postes et Télégraphes, and he had a career that you know. He was also very hard working.
What is that picture?
What?
The previous picture.
Previous picture. It's Henri Poincaré giving a discourse in 1910, I think. It is for Octave Greard. Henri Poincaré was also a very hard working scientist. And so you have a selection with a quite a kind of variety. So you have some philosophy, you have some physics, you have some philosophy, some bibliography, and so on. And we could go on very long. Poincaré wrote more than 600 books and articles. His collected works, which are far from being complete, are almost 6,000 pages long. And of course, there are translations you probably know. Poincaré was also a member of academies and learned societies. Here is the complete list. We don't read it yet. And he won a lot of prizes and distinctions. If you turn back to our question now, who was Henri Poincaré? And knowing the importance of his life and works, it appears that it is quite difficult to give a precise answer to such a simple question. Henri Poincaré was an engineer, a mathematician, a professor, a philosopher, a pedagogue, a research administrator, an astronomer, a physicist, and a committed intellectual. So here you have, as an example, a sample, the report he made during the Affaire Dreyfus that was signed by him and Darboux and Appel. But this is the most visible part of Henri Poincaré, I think. Henri Poincaré was also... I don't want to go into the detail. I don't have time, but I will. Sorry?
More or less.
More or less. He was in favor of the innocence of Dreyfus for scientific reasons. I will give you an article about that. So Poincaré was also a son, a pupil, a student, a husband, a father, a cousin, a small-time speculator, a music lover, a great traveler, and so on. And if we try to go further in this kind of inventory, he was also a young man, a very funny guy with a quite absurd sense of humor, a kind of cynical observer of his family, relatives, and friends, and a somewhat calculating person in the choice of his social relations. And as we can see, in a few slides, I have presented you various dimensions of Poincaré's life, and we could consider them, in some extent, as separate spheres. Some of these spheres concerned Poincaré's public life as a scientist, a scholar, a university professor. Some of the spheres are related to his private life, his relationship with his family and friends, with his neighbors, cousins, parents, sons, daughters, friends, enemies, and so on. But is it that simple? A quick look to Poincaré's death announcement reveals the difficulty to disentangle all these private and public dimensions. So I don't know if you can read, but I have outlined some names. So you can read Raymond Poincaré, Lucien Poincaré, Albin Allaire, Geoffroy Saint-Hilaire, etc. His father was a physician and had political responsibilities in the town council of Nancy. One of his uncles was a polytechnician and an engineer des Ponts des Chaussées. His cousins were Raymond Poincaré, of course, but also Lucien Poincaré, who was to be the rector of the Académie de Paris, and Albin Allaire, a very influential chemist and a member of the Academy of Science. If we have a look at his family in law, we can find one of the most important philosophers of the time, Émile Boutroux, several generations of bankers, the Poulain-Dancy family, and several generations of naturalists, the Geoffroy Saint-Hilaire family, and so on. And if we have a look to his social networks, we can find a quite impressive address book. So what is private, what is public? Everything is mixed up in Poincaré's trajectory, and it's almost impossible to draw a clear separation between these different aspects. So here we have to face the constitutive enigma of any biographical attempt. Is it possible to give a general picture of the life and work of such a scientist? Is it possible to disentangle what belongs to the intimate private sphere and what belongs to the public, the professional sphere? Can we consider a single life, Poincaré's life, of course, but also that of an average person, an individu lambda, as a global unity in which all events are tied to each other in a rather continuous way? So the answer is clearly no. So the aim of my talk is not to propose a kind of criticism of the so-called biographical illusion, but I would like to insist on the fact that any biography is a narrative fiction. The role of the biographer is to organize, to stage a continuity in order to give a signification to the life of an individual. An ordered and continuous life cannot exist without a biographer. It is he who creates the life of the individual. But on the other hand, too much continuity may sound problematic. So if you have a look at this kind of list, a good exercise is to find out who are these persons and why are they here during the funeral. And we have some strange persons. I don't know if I can find it. We have, for instance, Le Bey de Tunis during the funeral of Poincaré. So if I turn back to my main topic, the death of Henri Poincaré in 1912, as can be expected, this event gave rise to a true flood of articles, necrologies, obituaries, and so on. During the last years of his life, Poincaré was very well known as a scientist and as a learned intellectual. His name appeared frequently in the daily press, especially after his election at the Académie Française in 1909. Every journal, be it local or national, had to publish an evocation of his life and work. And in a few days, a considerable collection of stories, fictions, moral tales, and so on, was written about Poincaré. So what are the general features of these stories? What can we learn from them about Poincaré's life and work? What role did they play in the construction of a biographical matrix from 1912 to the 1950s? These are the questions that I would like to address. As you know, the death of great men is often the starting point for biographical endeavors. But in some cases, the work can start long before. And in the case of Poincaré, it began probably in 1897. That's why I will argue that Poincaré was dead twice. It's quite paradoxical, but we will understand soon. And it will be my first scoop. I have some other ones at the end. So in the first part of my talk, I will deal with Poincaré's first little death. That is to say, the moment when he was celebrated with his clear consent as a genius by Edouard Toulouse. But a genius that was not so far from a retarded child. In the second part, I will deal with the very moment of his death, that is the 4 or 5 days after July the 17th. And finally, in a third part, I will deal with Poincaré's afterlife and biographical posterity and propose some concluding remarks. So I switch now to my first part, which is the longer one. Around the end of the 1890s, Poincaré was quite like a national monument. And some elements tend to attest that, metaphorically speaking, he was already dead, or almost dead. So the first death of Poincaré is directly linked with Edouard Toulouse. So as you can see, Toulouse was a physician, a psychologist, and a sexologist. He was to be the founder of the French League for prophylaxis and hygiene mentale. So in the 1890s, Toulouse started his career with some kind of researches on intellectual superiority. Like some other physicians and psychologists, such as Cesare Lombroso, for instance, his aim was to establish a link between genius and nephropathy. It was a fashionable topic at that time, but unlike his competitors, he thought that it was not necessary to wait for the death of the subject. So rather than collecting the skulls of the dead geniuses, he interested himself in those of the living. And he had some prestigious guinea pigs, cobaye in French. So he had the sculptors Auguste Rodin and Jules Dalou, the poet Sully Prudhomme, the chemist Marcelin Berthelot, and icing on the cake, Émile Zola and Henri Poincaré. It's Henri Poincaré at that time, I think, approximately. The first result of Toulouse's researches in this field was a book devoted to Émile Zola that was published in 1896. So with the help of Francis Galton, Léonce Manouvrier, Charles Henry, Jules Jamin Crépieux, and Alphonse Bertillon, Toulouse had managed to draw a physiological and psychological portrait of Zola. So in this book, the reader could learn almost everything about Zola's intimate life, his teeth, his myopia, his urination and intestinal movements, his visual, sensory and emotional memory, his sexual morbid ideas, and so on. You can read it, it's online, I will give you the address. Although this study was made with the consent of Zola, and perhaps because of Zola's consent and reputation, Toulouse's book was to be strongly criticized, and he finally resigned to publish the results of his other studies. We have a publication on a very short publication of the study on Berthelot, one page, and the other study is about Poincaré. And so, what for Poincaré? So Toulouse was obliged to resign. This explains why his second book on Poincaré was published much later in 1910. Toulouse probably thought that the election of Poincaré at the Académie Française in 1909 was a great opportunity to publish the results of the measurements he had made on him in 1897. And it was probably a kind of publishing stunt. So what was Toulouse's methodology? So his aim was to understand intellectual superiority with the help of medical and psychological tools such as medical exams, you have it here, family history, heredity, craniometry, and so on, mental and graphological tests, interviews, and questionnaires on the sense of life. Thus, Toulouse's aim was to elaborate a physiological and psychological biography. So you can see the table of content of the book on Poincaré. So it begins with heredity, development, medical examination, if you want, tests, psychological tests. So you can see mémoire additive, mémoire tactile, mémoire musculaire, and so on, and so on, and so on. We have graphs, and so on. It's almost 300 pages long. We can have a test concerning attention, language, and we have the conclusions, the problem of the genius, and the case of Poincaré. So if you read this book, what can you find? You can find first a description of the body of the scientist. So you can read that Poincaré had a big nose, a big red nose, and a big belly. You can also read that his craniometrical results were quite good. So better than Zola. Zola is here, Dalou is here. So his anencephalic is better than Zola's and Dalou's, for instance. He was brachycephal. You can also learn his digestion was good, that he did not smoke, that his perspiration was abundant, and so on. Moreover, we can learn that Poincaré suffered from a lack of hearing for low sounds and was affected by dysuria, so some bladder troubles. But this is not all. You can also explore the mind of the scientist. Just like his body, Henri Poincaré's psychological configuration was deeply analyzed by Toulouse. His ability for memory calculation was measured, and he was also submitted to a whole battery of mental tests. So association of ideas, for instance, visual memory, and so on. So you have a test on a reproduction memory, so the drawing is from Poincaré. Okay, and you have a test for association of ideas. So I don't know if you can read. It is this column is written by Toulouse, and it is the answers by Poincaré. So you can read moustache, pistache, chimère, chimène, force vive, cause finale, fleur de lys, and so on. Yes. One of the most interesting results of Toulouse was the fact that Poincaré was presented with colored audition symptoms. That means that the audition of letters of the alphabet was associated in Poincaré with colored images following a precise correspondence table. Sorry, it's not here. So you see Poincaré had the sensation of blanc légèrement teinté de bleu. And so on. It's a quite common symptom, audition colorée. Sorry?
Rimbaud a fait un poème sur les voyelles. C'est Baudelaire.
Je vous la jugez. Hein. Furthermore, Poincaré was asked to give an answer to various questions concerning his common ideas. Religion, politics, women's rights, and so on. So we can learn that he was a believer when he was young, that he was a moderate Republican, that he was for political equality and individual property, and that he was not opposed, in theory, to give women some political right. Sur le droit politique des femmes, il ne fait pas d'objection théorique, mais il craint l'influence cléricale sur leur action politique. Mais il veut bien leur donner des droits civiques. Toulouse's final diagnostic was certainly not a monument to the glory of Henri Poincaré. Toulouse remained quite cautious with the concept of genius and his relations with mental disease. As a scientist, Poincaré was an almost normal person and probably a quite annoying man because of the routine of his daily life. Nevertheless, one of Toulouse's conclusions was that Poincaré constituted a good model for the pathological study of retarded children. So the question in French would be, qu'allait-il faire dans cette galère? So Poincaré was thus described as a kind of weak pathological anomaly, and yet he gave Toulouse the authorization to publish his book. Je vous autorise très volontiers à publier les observations que vous avez faites sur moi en 1910. And moreover, he recommended Toulouse in 1911 for the obtaining of the rank of officer in the Legion d'honneur, which he did not obtain. This means that he was quite happy with the results. In fact, one can formulate two explanations to this apparent paradox. The first explanation is probably that Poincaré liked honors and distinctions. He had a sharp sense of his public image and of his career, and this book probably played a role in Poincaré's self-fashioning, self-staging. We have many examples of this situation, but this one is kind of striking and quite funny also. It's Poincaré on the chocolate advertising. The second explanation is probably more important. Poincaré was very interested by psychology and introspection, and this came probably from his father, Émile Léon Poincaré, who was a physician and a specialist of the nervous system. And of course, his essay on mathematical invention is a living proof of this interest, as for his collaboration to the investigation on the working habits of mathematicians in 1912, I think. So I will conclude this first part with a general conclusion. Toulouse's book is a kind of medical biography, if you want. The insistence of the banality of everyday life seemed to be quite trivial or unhealthy. In a sense, Poincaré's works are explained in Toulouse by his body, his physiological functioning, and his psychological or mental configuration. Do we need to know whether Poincaré used to drink coffee in the evening or suffered from dysuria? This may seem quite anecdotic compared to the importance of his work. But on the other hand, Toulouse gives us a precious outlook of something that often remains inaccessible, the working habits of scientists. Thanks to his book, we can see Poincaré at work in everyday life. We can have a precise idea of his daily working rhythm. We can see the routine of the elaboration of her work. We can feel the fatigue, the weariness, the effort of intellectual work. In other words, we can see the labor of the work. Now, there's an expression from a colleague, Anne Collineau, which gives a quite good account of this, but I don't know how to translate it in English. In French, it would be l'œuvre travail. We can see l'œuvre travail de Poincaré. Of course, it's a kind of layout. It's a mise en scène. But I think it's interesting in that way. So, Toulouse proposed a kind of dissection of in vivo, just as if Poincaré was dead. But as you know, Poincaré really died in 1912. So Poincaré's death gave rise to a somewhat hagiographical fluid. This will be my second part. And as we will see, the celebration of Poincaré's genius will also be the celebration of a kind of pathological disorder. So my main source here is Mittag-Leffler's press review at the time of Poincaré's death. Mittag-Leffler had collected more than 30 articles that were published between the announcement of Poincaré's death and his funeral. So here are some topics that we can find in this press review. A disaster. So Paul Painlevé wrote that his death was a great disaster and that some great discoveries would be delayed. You have a reference to the brain. It's quite important. I will go on that. The work, a hardworking mathematician. According to Alphonse Berger, Poincaré's work was like the Eiffel Tower. When you are close to it, you cannot estimate its height. Ernest Lajeunesse calculated that Poincaré had published almost 2,000 books and articles, which is, of course, an exaggeration. You can see the Patriot, the Lorrain. Paul Painlevé made a clear allusion to the Franco-Prussian War. Et que cet homme fut un des leurs, qu'il fut né en pleine terre lorraine, qu'il parla leur langue, c'était pour eux une raison de fierté, proudness, et de réconfort, noble patriotisme et légitime orgueil. For George Imbert, Poincaré was a conqueror, a kind of Alexander the Great. We have also the hard-working scientist. Poincaré was a soldier and a laborer of science. And then we can find some new references on Poincaré's tired and sloppy body. So here you have an accurate, or somewhat accurate description of Poincaré's body. A big red head, some myopic eyes, a common and not very handsome face, a heavy body, quite deformed by everyday work, a hazardous work, and so on. L'air d'un homme qui ne cesse pas de songer à autre chose que vous. Very strikingly, Poincaré's genius is in the identified with his body, once more. The importance of his genius and of his works can be materially exemplified by the contemplation of his general allure. And you have the brain. The evocation of Poincaré's brain is also quite common in the articles published at the moment of his death. Painlevé claims that Poincaré was the living brain of rational sciences. Alphonse Berger, that Poincaré lived in perpetual connections with his thoughts, and that they were the only worthy company for his brain. C'est la seule compagnie qui soit digne de leur cerveau, sur les lobes duquel elle se reflète en se multipliant comme une lumière au milieu d'un groupe de mémoire. And you have also the unspeakable. So, Alphonse Berger, once more. Ai-je pu donner dans ces quelques lignes un aperçu exact de ce qu'était ce génie vaste et exceptionnel? Je ne le crois pas. Bon, c'est raté. De tels génies possèdent des secrets, so geniuses have secrets, cela est clos, it's impossible, et nous ne voyons en quelque sorte que les bords de cette ésotérique pensée. So you cannot enter this thinker. Donc, so to conclude with this press review, most authors wrote that Poincaré's genius was unspeakable and that no one would ever be able to reach the depths of his esoteric thoughts. So in this text, Poincaré is both present and absent. He is of course present because he is the subject, but he is absent since it is quite impossible to access his work or his self. Or rather, he is one with his works, his books, articles, prizes, distinctions, and all these things are a summary of his whole life. So we have a kind of naturalization of his works, where everything that he produced is reduced, or almost reduced, to his neglected body. So Poincaré was thus transformed into an abstraction, into an idealized character, a solitary genius, an absent-minded thinker obsessed by the elaboration of his theories, an asocial, or poorly adapted to the usages of social life, an ethical model for the population, a pure and selfless scientist. Finally, these articles say very little about Poincaré's life. They serve as polite fictions in a rather conventional exercise, obituaries, necrologies, and so on. Poincaré's fiction serves as a model for a kind of republican and idealized representation of science. So it might be a quite trivial story. This kind of journalistic phenomenon is not really new. The same exercise with Louis Pasteur's death would probably give the same results: caricature, exaggerations, hagiographies, moral generalizations about the social role of science, and so on. So if you read the first paragraph, I read it in French. L'œuvre de Pasteur a été grande et d'autres plus qualifiés en parleront tout à l'heure. Mais sa vie a aussi été grande et sa vie appartient à tout le monde, aux ignorants comme aux savants.
Elle est un exemple admirable de volonté, de ténacité, de modestie, de bonté et en laissant au mot toute sa force de vertu. Elle mérite de figurer au premier rang de celles que les hommes se racontent de siècle en siècle pour entretenir et aviver la flamme des nobles inspirations.
So we are then confronted with a specific genre, which have its own style and rhetoric, the tribute, the homage to the memory of a great man. And if we find, and if we follow this track, the track of the homage, we can see of the patrimoine. We can see that it produced a large number of results from the 1910s until the 1960s.
So we have buildings, Lycée Henri Poincaré in 1930 in Nancy, Institut Henri Poincaré in 1925, an hydroelectric plant Henri Poincaré in the 50s, and you have also boats, submarines, cruise ships, warships.
It is here necessary to mention the fact that the most part of these tributes were made by the mathematician Émile Borel, who had the political power to do so. But this is another story. And there we are at a point where private and public spheres have strong interactions.
So here you can find that it's an article in Le Temps in 1925, where we have the indication that Émile Borel decided to give the name Henri Poincaré to this submarine. It was a campaign of a nomination of boats and submarines.
And there are strong interactions between private and public. I give you an example. The Boutroux family,
Poincaré was, Émile Boutroux was a brother-in-law of Poincaré.
The Boutroux family was very close to the Appel family, and Borel had married Appel's daughter. But furthermore, it appears that Pierre Boutroux had been a courtisan of Camille Appel.
So, in one sense, everything is in everything, and reciprocally. And so what is private and what is public life? So we have this kind of interaction, and if we have a look at the marriage, the weddings in the mathematical community at this time, at the time of Poincaré, you can find some strong interactions in terms of family. So there is a moral to the story.
First, do not die in July. If Poincaré was dead a few weeks earlier or later, he would have entered the Panthéon,
like Berthelot, and not Pasteur.
Secondly, do not die before World War I. A lot of projects were made at the Academy of Sciences around Poincaré's memory, but the war put an end to them, and for instance, the edition of the collected work of Poincaré, as you know, took more than 50 years because of frequent financial problems.
And there you have a short text of Appel in 1925, where he writes that the Academy had the intention to create a prize, Poincaré Prize, and there was a lack of money, and it was abandoned. So I switch now to my third part.
Soon after Poincaré's death, a large number of articles and monographs were published on Poincaré's works. One of the first was probably that of Volterra, Adamar, Langevin, and Boutroux, Pierre Boutroux, that was published in a collection that was directed by Émile Borel. This book was in fact a compilation of articles that had been published elsewhere, and rather significantly, it proposed a thematic account of Poincaré's works, from the point of view of disciplines considered as closed and unified.
So you have a section about, you can read, I think, a section about the l'œuvre mathématique. You have Le problème des trois corps, it's quite special, by Adamar. You have Le physicien and l'œuvre philosophique by Pierre Boutroux.
This kind of choice was to be usual for forthcoming books on Poincaré. Of course, this book did not belong to the biographical genre. The only biographical section is a short curriculum vitae,
It is a three pages long, and you have his curriculum.
Until 1956, various intellectual, philosophical, and scientific biographies of Poincaré were written in France and abroad. But it is more difficult to find complete biographies of the mathematician. And I insist on the word complete. Complete in what sense? Complete in the sense that they would intend to draw a general account, story, if you want, about Poincaré's life and work from the cradle to the grave. So I'm sorry, I don't have any photograph of Poincaré's cradle, but we have his grave. And you can't see, I think, but it's important for the end of my talk. His sister Aline was buried with him. Of course, when I make a plea for a complete biography, this is not a value judgment about scientific biographies. So if we choose such a criterion, so from the cradle to the grave, the list is quite short. The first biography in that sense is probably the Eulogy written by Gaston Darboux in 1913, first one. The second biography attempt of this type is, with no doubt, Paul Appel's book published in 1925. The last one on my list was written by a less known poet and novelist, André Bellivier. It is here. The title of his book, published in 1956, shortly after Poincaré's birth centennial, was Henri Poincaré ou la vocation souveraine, so the sovereign vocation of Poincaré. So, for Darboux and Appel, the first source of their writings is probably their recollection of their friendly relationships with Poincaré. Appel was a close friend of Poincaré at the lycée in Nancy, and Darboux was to be very close to him during his career, as you know. In fact, these three books have one thing in common. They all take a decisive part of their material from a text that was published in 1909. It is this one, Frédéric Masson's speech when Poincaré officially entered the Académie Française. In this text, Masson had made a considerable effort to obtain biographical information about Poincaré's childhood in Nancy, from his friend and relative, especially from his sister Aline, who was, as you know now, Émile Boutroux's wife. But Darboux, Appel, and Bellivier, and even Masson and some other biographers, had access to another biographical material, and it is this one. Aline Boutroux's memoirs on her youth in Nancy during the 1860s and the Franco-Prussian War. Poincaré's sister had begun to write a manuscript around 1908 or 1909, and Masson had, with no doubt, the opportunity to read some extracts. Aline Boutroux finished up his writing in 1913. She did not have any intention to publish it and wanted to keep it in the family circle. But despite this choice, Darboux was authorized to use it for his eulogy. This was also the case for Appel and Bellivier after Aline Boutroux's death. Until today, so 1912, this manuscript remained confidential, although it was regularly used as a source material by a few biographers. So I have published it this year, so it's a kind of advertising. This source is an important one, but its main focus is only Poincaré's youth. This explains why this part of his life is very well documented in the existing biographies at the expense of some other aspects of his life. Another problem is probably their teleological orientation. In all these books and Aline manuscript, there is a kind of heroic storytelling. Everything in Poincaré's youth had to lead to the masterpiece of his life and works. Consequently, there is an exaggerated insistence on his alleged scientific vocation. Clearly, for all these authors, the main objective is not only a biographical one, but also an educative and ethical one.
So you have the presentation of the collection Noble Vie Grandes Oeuvres, in which the Book of Appel was published. And you can read le récit de la vie mouvementée et généreuse d'un homme qui poursuit un idéal et lui sacrifie tout. Certaines vies, certaines œuvres sont plus belles que les plus belles aventures imaginées. Et on va donner, we will give some luminous examples. The collection in which Bellivier published his book was the collection Vocations. The intention is to explain la croissance d'une pensée créatrice et l'éveil de la vocation. And so on, and so on. This produced some strange consequences, such as this one. So you can learn, this is also a scoop, that Poincaré was already the owner of the chair of astronomy when he was 9 months old. So it's from Aline Boutrou, but it's also in the speech of Masson. And you can find it quite repeatedly, many repeated. So there is an heredity. Vous étiez prédestiné aux mathématiques. L'aptitude dans votre famille paternelle et maternelle s'en transmet en ligne collatérale. Voilà. Vous aviez 9 mois lorsque, pour la première fois, la nuit venant, vos yeux se portèrent sur le ciel. En colo, là-bas. Ce soir-là, vous aviez pris votre premier contact avec l'infini et vous aviez inauguré vos cours d'astronomie. On ne saurait professer plus jeune. So some concluding remarks. So to conclude, I would like to ask a simple question. What's the problem with Poincaré? Poincaré's biographies constitute a very rare resource. Nevertheless, this rarity cannot be explained by a lack of archival sources. We have plenty of things, from his correspondence to indirect sources and monographies. So what's the problem? Recently, several books on Poincaré were published. They propose a variety of points of view. So you have Ginouz and Gérini's book, which is a study of Poincaré's appearance in French daily press. You have Ferdinand Verhulst's book, which was published this year, and Jeremy Gray's, which is a forthcoming book. The main purpose of these books is to give an outlook of Poincaré's public and scientific life. And as we have seen, this is not really a simple question. And if you read this declaration of Ferdinand Verhulst, you have a confirmation of that. And the confirmation that Poincaré is a great problem. After working for several years on this biography, I remarked to a German colleague and friend, I have to stop this, Poincaré is too great for me. He did not give up. There was another obstruction. Poincaré was an explorer and an adventurer, but of the jungles, deserts, and mountains of the spirit. He made fantastic journeys, but all those adventures took place in his mind. How can one describe such an exciting life that from the outside looks so dull? And so on. And so he couldn't sleep at night. So Poincaré is probably a kind of Eiffel Tower. But this does not mean that we should stop and simply consider it as an inaccessible monument. The Eiffel Tower is too large for us, but it is made of nuts, bolts, and beams, and it is perhaps in the multiplication of local studies on these small pieces that we can approach Poincaré's life and works. And to finish, I will give you a few examples. So we have so much things to explore, and we have a few scoops. First, Henri Poincaré's wife and family-in-law. So Poincaré's marriage with Louise Poulain d'Andecy was not anecdotal. Her family had powerful political and scientific connections and helped him to obtain a position in Paris. So on that point, I have written a short article. I can give it to you if you are interested. Secondly, Henri Poincaré's unknown works. Everybody among us is looking for unpublished documents. One of them is a novel that he wrote at the beginning of his career as an engineer in Vesoul. Thanks to Scott, we now have it at our disposal. And this is, I think, a decisive monument, a document, sorry, on Poincaré's cultural practices and on his imaginary and mental universe. So so if you read this novel, there you cannot read it. You have a story about a small city, which is called X. In that city, you have some polytechnicians. You have a ball. Un bal, c'est ça?
A dance.
With sociability. You have adultery things, and so on, and so on. Third, Henri Poincaré's financial situation. You cannot read. Once again, thanks to Scott, we have access to his declaration of estate at the moment of his death, and we can now estimate the financial weight of his marriage and the importance of his personal fortune, which seemed quite considerable. Another example would be Poincaré's political connections. So this is a quite important point. I won't go into detail, but all these persons, who are minister, deputy, senator, chief of staff in Jules Ferry's cabinet, mayor of Nancy, director of the École des Mines, deputy, and so on, had strong relationship with the Poincaré family and played a role in the fashioning of Poincaré's career. To finish, Poincaré's social networks. So on the right, you have the top 14 most quoted persons in Poincaré's personal correspondence. So the question is simple. Do you know these names? Raymond, Raymond Poincaré, that's right. Aline, of course, but the other. The family rank appears this number of times. So you can see, this is the rest of the list. Do you know these names? You have Boutroux, Laguerre, Bonnet, Alphen, Le Cornu, and you have some other ones that we don't know. And these other ones meant something for Poincaré. In Poincaré's life, in Poincaré's daily life, in Poincaré's relationships. So, for instance, Billy, for instance, Madame Brice. Every Sunday, Poincaré went to Madame Brice, so when he was at the École Polytechnique. So, I think there is some work to do, and it's this work that I try to make in order to ordinate and inform this kind of information. My last slide, a final conclusion. So 5 years ago, Todd Haynes realized a wonderful movie about Bob Dylan's creative life. And you have here a quotation of the letter sent by Todd Haynes to Bob Dylan in order to explain him the project of his film. So clearly, I let you read it. Clearly, this point of view cannot be that of a biography of Poincaré. If you have the occasion to see this movie, if you don't know Bob Dylan, if you don't know anything about Bob Dylan, you won't learn anything about Bob Dylan. So it's quite a problem. But its insistence on discontinuity and contingency seems to me a very interesting point that we should have in mind if we intend to tell Poincaré's life from the cradle to the grave. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Great. Please, any comment, question?
Yes, four. Three daughters and a son.
Any mathematicians?
What do you call a mathematician? His son, Léon Poincaré, was to be up at the École Polytechnique. And he was an engineer at the, in the Corps des Mines. But he was not a mathematician. But I learned this morning that he was to translate some letters from Klein to Poincaré. That's it.
So I have a provocative question. Did we learn anything about Poincaré by all these details? I will take an example that René Thom liked very much. He said if you look at a clock, at a watch, and you put apart all the pieces, then you won't know the most important thing, which is the échappement, which is the conservation of energy. So what is the conservation of energy for Poincaré?
I prefer to let the question open. What do you want to know about Poincaré?
No, it's not clear that knowing all the biographical details, you learn anything important about really what matters for Poincaré.
But it depends on what you want to call a biography. If you want a scientific biography, that's all right. We have one. But if you want to have an idea of the creative imagination of Poincaré, the way in which Poincaré educates himself, enters in relationships with his family, his acquaintances, and so on. At least, unless I was not informed, there is nothing about Poincaré, about this kind of thing. So the question is, what kind of biography do you want?
You explained to us the difficulty of writing a biography of a mathematician like Poincaré. Mm. Do you know one example of a biography of some other mathematician that satisfies your criteria? Or is it a general problem about
biography? My intention was not to propose a criterion.
So do you have a good example of what you would consider a satisfying biography?
I think that, he's not a mathematician, but on Einstein, we have a lot of documentation which have a biographical ampleur, if you want. In the case of Poincaré, we don't have it. But it will be in French.
Yes, a little provocative question. This is near to Alain Chansigner's question. I think we learn a lot of things of Raymond Poincaré, because Raymond Poincaré just was elected 6 months after Henri Poincaré's death to the President of the Republic. So, and by this, so the death of Poincaré, Henri Poincaré was surely a public, a very good public moment for Raymond. I don't know. I have no idea if there is a lot of campaign for the. In this time for the French president, I have no idea, but it was prime minister in this time. So,
in a sense, my question that it's, at least for me, it's not clear that Poincaré's biography is more interesting than anyone's biography.
I agree with you.
Maybe it's interesting.
But Poincaré's biography is the only thing that I can do. I don't know anything else. So. It's my point.
But maybe for me, not being French, it's interesting how he became this kind of demigod, semi-god. No? And I was wondering, related to the question that Etienne was proposing, what happened in the 30 years on many of the things that were lost, on many of the... So the people were talking so much about Poincaré, but maybe many of his mathematical heritage, at this time that everybody was talking, he was kind of lost. So why?
So I had one comment and also one question. The first is the comment is that I'm not sure I agree with you when you say there is one genre of eulogies in the papers you you showed us after the death of Poincaré, or even before, probably, in the newspapers, yes, and so on. And this issue has been studied recently by Anne-Gaëlle Weber from Anne-Gaëlle Weber, who is a scholar in literature, who has been studied this kind of discourses from the point of view of literature, and she has shown that actually there are several genres. So of course you have the genre of eulogies, which is very old; it changes, and in a way it still exists today. And so you have eulogies from scientific authorities, so at the time, for instance, Borel or Adamar and so on. And some of the times, you can find them in newspapers, in some newspapers, and sometimes simplified, as you showed us with, for instance, the case of Pasteur in Le Temps. But in some other newspapers, you will have, they can be mocked or they can be criticized for several reasons. It can be the political line of the newspaper, or it can also be, for instance, in the case of André Bonnier, it can also be disciplinary boundaries. For instance, André Bonnier is writing a lot of criticism about art and literature and so on, and is writing many papers about the eulogies of mathematicians, Galois, Abel, Poincaré, and he's always mocking the authorities of mathematics. For instance, in the case of Galois, is making clear that he cannot say anything about Galois because he doesn't have the mathematical capacities to do so. So he has to appeal to authorities of mathematics, and he's citing them. And then he's making some conclusions like, ce sont les camelots du sublime, ils ont des tours, ce sont les clowns de la vérité, or these kind of things. So I think there are several genres. And so then there comes my question. The same scholar, Anne-Gaëlle Weber, also showed in the case of Galois that for a long time he could not fit in the kind of genre of scientific biography of the 19th century. And she also studied the biographies of Galois in the 20th century and the attempts to create a kind of specific genre in the case of Galois. And so my question was, do you have the aim to create a specific genre of biography for dealing with this problem of Poincaré?
Not at all. No.
So then can you precise what you responded before? So you said, for instance, in the case of Einstein, we would be satisfied. So what kind of genre of biography is it that you're looking for?
I will reply in French. mon intérêt pour la biographie de Poincaré, d'un certain point de vue, je ne sais faire que du Poincaré. Je suis Poincaré au fil. Et donc, je n'ai travaillé pratiquement que sur Poincaré, sur d'autres choses, pendant une bonne dizaine d'années. Et donc, mon intérêt pour une biographie de Poincaré n'est pas trop théorique. Donc, je ne vais pas te dire que j'ai une intention théorique en proposant une biographie de Poincaré. Mon intérêt, c'est d'exploiter toutes les petites pièces de matériel, the broken pieces of facts, qu'on peut trouver ici et là, les rassembler et en faire une histoire, une histoire d'une vie de Poincaré qui ne serait pas uniquement sa vie scientifique, mais ce qu'il y a à côté de sa vie scientifique. Et bien sûr, la séparation entre ce qui est scientifique et ce qui ne l'est pas, c'est une question qui est redoutable, et surtout avec lui. Parce que ce que j'ai essayé de montrer, c'est que justement, quand on prend des acteurs, tu sais aussi bien que moi, quand on prend des acteurs connus, on se rend compte que les interactions sociales sont tellement énormes, et ne sont pas simplement scientifiques ou académiques ou professionnelles, qu'on est sans cesse un peu décontenancé par l'ampleur de la tâche. Et donc, c'est grosso modo, c'est ça qui m'intéresse. Et ce qui m'intéresse, c'est de replacer Poincaré dans la culture de son temps, dans son contexte, voir ses habitudes sociales, ses habitus, le remettre dans une perspective moyenne. Poincaré, c'est pas la moyenne, hein, mais le mettre dans une perspective moyenne du savant de la Troisième République, et voir quelle est sa place, aussi bien socialement, intellectuellement, politiquement, etc. Donc ce que j'ai un peu fait dans ma thèse, mais que j'aimerais bien le faire aussi d'un point de vue biographique, d'un point de vue plus général. Mais je ne le ferai pas seul, de toute façon. Et donc, on est plusieurs à préparer ce genre de choses. J'espère qu'on y arrivera. Mais je n'ai pas de projet, théorique autour de ça. Je ne sais pas si ça te satisfait, mais voilà.
To go back to Alain's problematic, in fact, I have also problems with biographies, as you know. So something which I found extremely important and interesting for the history of mathematics is to understand what is a mathematical life at any time. And I think it's a real problematic issue, because at some times it would mean only looking at the mathematics when I'm thinking of André Weil saying my dharma was to do only mathematics, and it's very important for him, even if it's not true, to distinguish between what is really mathematics and what is not. And we have all anecdotes of people saying, well, I'm doing, for instance, my pastime is to do mathematics and not my profession, and so on. At other time, of course, doing politics, and even real politics, is part of a mathematical life. And I think it's very important even to understand the mathematics. For instance, I have in mind the Bezos case with the biography by Liliane Alfonsi, where if you look only at what Bezos did in his activity of the academy, you missed some of his most important theorems, because the theorems were put into textbooks which he had to write because he was sent on a very bizarre path to examine people everywhere in France and so on and so on. So you have to understand what was completely seen as a part of his mathematical life to understand that. At the end of the 19th century, and it's not only for mathematicians, it's also for scientists, the domestic life was part of the life in general, and also the professional life. I mean, you have the situation for the naturalist, where the wives were sent to collect drawings of species and things like that, and you have all family network helping for the scientific work. And I'm thinking of Hermit. If you don't understand the manigance, I mean the maneuver of the Hermit's wife, also for the academy candidates, you don't understand certain position that Hermit would take or not. And you don't understand why some people were elected or not at the academy at some times. I mean, there are a lot of things going on in these family networks. So in this case, I mean, the question of what is a mathematical life is a very important issue, which is absolutely not trivial. And in that sense, I think we can say, okay, what you are doing is really very important, because we don't know exactly what is a mathematical life just before the First World War at the moment. And it's really in this direction, I think. And just to give you one question on this, something I would like very, very much to see is a schedule. What was a schedule? I mean, what was a day by Poincaré? How much time
read did Toulouse. In Toulouse, you have it. I don't know if it's the true.
Yeah, but is it? I mean, can you elaborate?
No,
because if you compare some sources, sometimes you have surprises. So,
confirm
or not? Toulouse?
I think that in Toulouse study there are some kind of rhetorical information, and in fact the study of Toulouse was made in the 80s. I can imagine that Poincaré. I switch into French. Sorry. J'ai du mal à imaginer que Poincaré ait gardé le même rythme de travail pendant 30 ans. Voilà. Et donc, on a une photographie à un moment T qui est peut-être très rhétorique, parce que finalement, il s'agit de publier quelque chose. Ça a bien sûr été relu par Poincaré. Et donc. Là, je ne suis pas sûr qu'on ait quelque chose d'absolument vrai, enfin, dans la généralité de la vie de Poincaré. Bon, maintenant, ça donne un indice. Et si c'est un bon objectif que de recouper. Je suis complètement d'accord avec toutes tes remarques sur la vie domestique et sur la vie domestique de Poincaré. Quand on regarde simplement, alors sa femme, j'en ai parlé, mais sa sœur aussi. C'est extrêmement important. Par exemple, la manière dont elle le conseille lorsqu'il va être candidat à l'Académie française. Puisque c'est elle qui lui dit « J'ai rencontré un tel, il faut que tu te reportes sur un tel fauteuil plutôt que sur un autre. » Elle est tout à fait dans ce genre de choses. Et un simple épisode comme la candidature de Poincaré à l'Académie française en 1908, c'est un parfait exemple du mélange entre ce qu'on appellerait la vie scientifique, ou la vie mathématique, et la vie, l'autre vie, s'il y en a une,
chez Poincaré, à savoir que il y a une sorte de négociation à cette époque avec entre l'Académie des sciences, entre des acteurs de l'Académie des sciences et l'Académie française, pour que Poincaré se retire d'une candidature à l'Académie des sciences, et ensuite les académiciens des sciences vont aider Poincaré à se faire élire à l'Académie française. On a des lettres de l'apparent qui sont assez explicites là-dessus. Et donc des négociations de ce type-là sont assez exemplaires de ce mélange. Et c'est pas une tâche facile. Donc, aucune biographie n'est facile à écrire, mais Poincaré en fait partie. Quoi, voilà.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, maybe there is a good example of the non-reliability of this kind of declarations. Of that there is a probably well-known movie of Bruno Mont-Saint-Jean on the pianist Sviatoslav Richter. And Richter says explicitly that he doesn't work, he doesn't make exercise. But in the movie, there is his neighbor who says he's working the whole day. So. And also, maybe as something a little amusing, I could propose another kind of biography, which is not really a biography, but I don't know if you know, in the first edition of the great Larousse dictionary, there is an article on Siméon Denis Poisson. And for different reasons, Larousse didn't like Poisson at all. And the article is really a murder. He said that in mathematics, in physics, and in politics, Poisson was always wrong. So
I was just going to answer a question that was asked to you about what is a good biography that you could think of. And this is one that I've read recently, which was the biography of Dirac. And one of the things that I thought by Farmelot was really, really well done in that was his insight into the Cambridge scene, the kind of British scene, and actually what that would tell people from outside Britain. And I think for me, one of the things that would be so immensely valuable is all those kind of insights into the French way of life and the French institutions and things that we kind of have, we sort of think we know from outside, but do we really know? And I think that can only be done from the inside, in the way that Farmelot did it from the inside for Dirac. So I think this is very valuable.
It's a good suggestion.
Yeah.
There is a little, it's not so little, a book that has been written by Benoît Peters. I don't know if you know him. Benoît Peters wrote a biography of Derrida, philosopher, and he wrote, after the writing of this book, a plea for biography, in which he explains what is his position as a biographer. And he gives some very nice advices on the way he thinks biography. It's not. I do not agree with all his choices, but it's quite interesting to read the convention that he wants to establish with the reader. And one of them is quite striking. He writes that for him, a good biography, would be the one in which the biographer don't go too further into the details. And concerning these names that I showed, his choice was to get some details on the person that meant something for Derrida, but not on the persons that were in relations with Derrida. So if you want to eliminate the details, I think it's a good choice. And I think that there is something to learn from this kind of point of view. I can give you the references, but I want also those concerning Dirac.
Yes, I think too that we have so many materials about Poincaré that it's a good occasion, perhaps not to call it a biography of Poincaré, but to show how is the how function the institutions in French and the politics and so on with a very distinguished scientist, which is involved in a lot of scientific politics in this country. So, and this is one. Perhaps we should not call it a biography of Poincaré, but another denomination. And on the other side, you see, when mathematicians are together, then they are very pleased to call anecdotes of this and that and so on. And from time to time, we can say, no, it is right. And we have documents which say the contrary of what you think. And all. So might be there is interaction between the social, a social field and the person of Poincaré, but not between the scientists. This is clear. Might be a little bit scientist too for the career, but not for the idea.
So, Laurent, what would you recommend as a suitable date for your death? So, what is a good date for death?
Oh, not
summer,
not the interwar.
No.
otherwise, I don't know.
So, one question: how many works on the, or how many books about the mathematical works of Poincaré have been published or have been collected? So it's not biographies, but works or books about the Poincaré works in mathematics.
Yes.
So how many books have been published of this? I only know the one that was edited like 10 years ago, maybe less, by Etienne.
Yeah.
But it's funny because there is apparently so many biographies, but there are no many books about his particular mathematical works.
In the 80s, you have a book by Broder, The Mathematical Heritage of Henri Poincaré. It's quite No, it's not.
Okay.
Etienne. And
in the first 50 years after his death.
I don't know.
Volume of the anniversary of
For the centennial of his birth, there was a lot of literature.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there was a big colloquium, I think, in La Hague. La Hague, in 1954. But after, I think if, you have to wait the 80s. We have, it's a bit later, we have science and philosophy. We had a big colloque on Poincaré in 1994. But it was also, it was mathematics and philosophy and logic and so on.
So any other comment? It's pretty alive, the discussion. Okay.